Christine Lagarde, direktorica Mednarodnega denarnega sklada, na vprašanje, ali jo kaj teži trpljenje grških državljanov.
Ne. Pomislim na majhne otroke iz šole v majhni vasici v Nigru, ki so deležni 2 ur pouka na dan, ki si po 3 delijo en stol in ki si srčno želijo izobrazbe. Neprestano mislim na njih, ker menim, da potrebujejo še več pomoči kot ljudje v Atenah.
In kako naj se Grki poberejo iz krize?
Tako da plačajo davke.
Kaj pa volitve?
Nekdo je nekoč rekel, da če ljudstvo ni zadovoljno z vlado, je treba pač zamenjati ljudstvo.
16. letnik Delavsko-pankrske univerze. Letošnja tema: dvojna kriza evrointegracij.
Okay, so the title of my talk is The Crisis of the Eurozone and the Crisis of Left Alternatives. So let's start with the claim. The claim is that it's not enough to say that the left must provide concrete alternatives to the crisis of the Eurozone, since this crisis is also widely felt to be one of left alternatives. So I think at the most general level we see today the intersection of 2 interrelated crises. The crisis of Marxism, since 1989, but arguably before that, is now combined and intensified by the crisis of capitalism. In 1989, Fukuyama announced the end of history, the end of systematic alternatives to capitalism, inaugurating an era of neoliberal hegemony, which saw the double collapse of the communist and socialist, social democratic projects, the decline of organized labor and its party form, and the marginalization of socialist thought. Today, in an ironic Hegelian dialectical reversal, the problem for Fukuyama is precisely that history cannot be brought to an end. In a recent article in a US establishment journal, Foreign Affairs, he writes that the tragedy is that there are no socialist alternatives to the anarchy of finance that could unite the disparate strikes, protests, and occupations, and he actually does use this language, that he could unite the struggle today into a unified transformative movement. So, even Fukuyama now actually feels that there needs to be some kind of alternative to history. History is now problematic for him. And I think that this sort of, in a way, summarizes the problem that we face today. So in other words, we have the greatest crisis of the system since the 30s, but this actually makes it harder for the left to pose alternatives. And what I want to really talk about is how do we actually pose that problem? Not so much in the sense of advocating any particular alternative, but actually what are the preconditions for an alternative to emerge? And I think here it's relevant to cite Sartre's misunderstood slogan or dictum that Marxism is the unsurpassable horizon of capitalism. Now, by this he did not mean that as long as capitalism existed, it would always produce something like a Marxist movement to abolish class society. He meant that if Marxism was surpassed, it could only be by way of a return to pre-Marxist forms of socialism. And I think this is what we've seen in the last 20 years. The predominant form of this is what Marx would have called utopian socialism. And he defined utopian socialism in the manifesto as, quote, violent opposition to all political action on the part of the working class. Violent opposition to political action. And in a way, I think this is quite sort of clear. The dominant slogan of the ultra-globalization movement is still change the world without taking power. Escape, refusal, and the flight from the state of capital are the order of the day. The phalansteries of Fourier and the communities of Cabet and Owen are alive and well, as theorists like Hart and Negri see the occupying encampments as showing the possibility of establishing a direct democracy outside of capitalism. However, the commons, the forms of self-management, cannot be established as long as the social power of capital remains intact. In other words, while the state stands guard over private property. And I think this is a sort of a widely felt problem within the movement, or rather within the movements that have emerged since Seattle, that they have run aground on simply the ability of the state to block these kinds of challenges. So what's missing here? I think what's absent is any kind of conception of socialism as a political project and as a political movement of the working people and its allies. However, I think this, it would be, I think, presumptuous to leave it at that, really. I think this is only a negative answer to a preliminary question. And that question is it realistic to imagine that a movement that seeks to replace the logic of capital with a different social logic can avoid a forcible confrontation with the existing state? So that would be the obvious reply to Hart and Negri. Can we imagine this kind of break without such a transformative moment? However, the real difficulty lies at a more concrete level. So if we still believe in something like socialism, what would be its preconditions? And I think that this is what I'll go on to talk about now, to look a little bit at the historical causes of the apolitical trend. And I'll do that by way of a contrast, by offering a kind of a stylized historical account of this transformation. I think it's important to remember that from the end of the 19th century, the belief in a coming radical social overturn, a radical social change, takes hold of the masses. The horizon of a social democracy is made possible and in turn shapes the development of a particular political subject, the industrial working class, with its own patterns of collective organization, struggle, and consciousness. Powerful socialist parties emerge as political vanguards, educating and inspiring workers in a heroic mission. I use the language deliberately because it's a language that's been dead probably since the 1930s. And that mission is the idea of working class leadership of the popular masses in the great cause of universal emancipation. I was actually quite shocked I did an interview with an anti-fascist activist who had been already a member of the Yugoslav Communist Party from the late 1920s, who had become a functionary in Tito's Yugoslavia, who had been a militant in the AFJ. And I talked to her a little bit about the 1930s in Yugoslavia, and she used that language. She said, "We understood our task as to inspire people to lead, to lead movements." In other words, it wasn't winning people to a line so much as winning them to the idea that their activity was what counted. So the idea of inspiring people in a great collective cause, I think, is fundamental to this experience, to the socialist experience. And in a way, what I think is important is that the unification of the socialist idea, on the one hand, with the working class on the other, inaugurates what I would call a time of class, in which personal and collective time come together. The sense of belonging to a class merges with that of belonging to a party. Personal history is part of collective history that summons workers to take their place in a progressive forward movement, to make personal sacrifices, and even to endure crushing defeats in a relentless and triumphal march to a better future. The time of class extends to that of everyday life, to working class culture. It is the time of education, improvement, and exercise. It is the rhythm of moments of festivity, commemoration, and struggle. Before 1917, the idea of the social change is dissolved into a kind of empty and homogeneous time of progress. In other words, a time of the social movement, of the construction of the social movement. This is the time of Bernstein and Kautsky. The Russian October marks a violent eruption of the event, of the future goal, into historical time. It also provides a model of change. The party is no longer the great teacher. It now must take initiatives to break open the horizon of change. But in order to do so, it must learn from the spontaneous struggle of workers. In other words, through the kinds of democratic alternatives that they create through the factory committees, the Soviets, and other forms of working class struggle. So in other words, there is now a dialectic within this idea of forward movement that brings together the personal and the collective. And in a way, it recalls Marx's slogan of the revolution in permanence. So in other words, the revolution must extend in space to cover the whole world, and in time until it reaches its final goal, the classless society. And it's from this standpoint that the limits of particular revolutions are judged. It's from this standpoint that they are found wanting and that they inspire new revolutionary efforts. And then the subsequent revolutions then in turn become models, so China, Cuba, Vietnam. The dialectic works the other way around, because revolutions compel reforms from above, but also they compel the development of a reformist socialist movement in opposition to the revolutionary trend. And I think after 1945, you see the kind of the strength and limits of this kind of dialectical movement. The Russian Revolution degenerates, but it becomes a model for industrialization in backward countries and for planning market economies. Whilst the very existence of the Soviet Union keeps the socialist horizon open. So, and this in itself obliges in the West strategies to incorporate labor movements in order to prevent revolution. And Western welfare capitalism marks the high point, I think, of this time of class. Because on the one hand, you have the incorporation of very bureaucratized labor movements into the management of society, the management of industrial relations, the planning of industry, and of welfare. And this, in turn, reinforces the weight, the social weight of the labor movement in capitalist society. However, at the same time, and I think this is very important for us to understand today, this kind of incorporation into the consumer society also means that certain functions that were controlled by the labor movement are now transferred vertically to the state and horizontally to the market. And I'm talking about things like education, culture, information, and welfare. The press, the newspapers of the labor movement, the educational societies, the cultural societies, all become either commodified or they become taken over by the state. So we're in the time of the culture industry. We're in the time of bureaucratic planning. And in a way, what happens is that the time of class becomes hollowed out from within. And personal destiny is slowly separated from collective destiny. Reformist parties cease to be class movements and instead become electoral machines. And the working class is no longer seen as a vanguard of a movement for change, of universal change, but becomes a corporate interest to be reconciled in a higher supposed national interest. May 68, I think, represents the last gasp, the last revolutionary effort of this particular historical time. It's a worker revolt against managerial and state bureaucracies in the East and in the West. But I think, crucially, it's also a movement of autonomy from structures that are felt to be oppressive, both the structures of the state, but also, for example, the structures within the family. The patriarchal family comes under question just as in the same sense as the patriarchal state. However, both in the course of 1968, but also as a result of its defeat, the idea of the social movement changes, its meaning changes. In the 19th century, the social movement meant the historical movement of the working class, or the working classes. from the 1970s, it begins to mean a diverse and merely eclectic range of movements that are not class-based. And these movements aim for autonomy from the state rather than for the transformation of the state. The social democratic project is broken on the rocks of successive recessions. The idea that you can plan to overcome the negative effects of the market comes under question. After 1989, the revolution is over, and now the idea of socialism basically loses its historical grounding and simply floats free into the air. And even worse, the terminology, the lexicon of socialism is turned around. It's captured by the right, by capitalism. So the idea of reform no longer means progressive popular control over the market, it means progressive control of the market over the people. The idea of revolution is no longer the breakthrough, it's the endless process of capitalist change, like the IT revolution or the fashion revolution. It becomes dissolved into the endless repetition of the same. The concept of progress, which defines class as a forward movement in history, which integrates the personal and the collective, comes under suspicion. This is the moment of postmodernism. So in other words, any attempt to change society as a whole is merely a mask for a particular interest, a particular will to power. And so in a way, we reach the time of neoliberalism and the time of the universalization of the market rather than of the popular movement, and the apparent end of politics in its sense since the ancient Greeks, as the struggle between rival and competing visions of the good life. So, as Fukuyama says, history apparently ends. So I think that the problem that we face is something that we know about, but we need to think about the historical basis for this. And my attempt to link the idea of political transformations that are based on some kind of idea of forward movement that integrates the personal and the collective in a universal historical project is broken apart. Because I think that this actually, our ability to offer alternatives is predicated on our ability to create a subject of change in the way that it was constructed in the 19th century. Because in the last 40 years, we've seen huge transformations in the life and the consciousness of the working classes. There's no vanguard anymore, in the sense of labor organizations whose identity and purpose are defined by a movement in time towards a socialist goal. The word vanguard isn't irrelevant, because clearly we still have leading economic and political organizations of the working class. However, the connections between these organizations and the popular classes have not only changed, they've not only become weaker, but they've changed in character. Social democracy is, for the most part, social liberalism. And where it still survives, it no longer seriously even pretends towards some kind of socialist project in the sense in the traditional sense of this word. We've seen the destruction the technological revolution, new management techniques have fragmented and divided the mass collective worker of Fordism. The working class no longer sees itself or is seen by society as a political subject of change, as the bearer of a socialist project, or as the leader of some kind of movement for universal freedom. Even reformist aspirations, the desire of people for a better society, a fairer or more equal society, considered in a very, very loose sense, no longer have any necessary connection with political parties, which is a problem that we can see within the left of the left. For example, the current problems of Die Linke are related to an ability, the question of actually creating a historical base for a project to the left of social democracy. So our first conclusion is that the tasks of the left today cannot be separated from the construction of a new political subject. The difficult, prolonged, and multifaceted process of struggle, organization, and political intervention required for a particular working class to start to imagine itself as more than simply an aggregation, a collection of wage laborers, as a political subject with a common identity and interests. Now, the question of creating a new subject of change, the basis for a new project, a new left project, another way of looking at this is that we, in a way, we are kind of, we're thrown back to some of the problems that Marx and Engels had to face after 1848. And by that I mean the slow disappearance of a particular historical vanguard, the kind of left that existed in the period of the 1820s, 1830s, and 1840s. And this is a movement based on artisan labor, a working class that has not yet been completely separated from the means of production, and therefore dreams of independent communes and the autonomy of free labor. So I'm talking about Proudhonism, for example, or Owenism, that is also hostile to trade unions, that's also hostile to political parties, that's also hostile to strike action, as well as the state. So in other words, we're talking about a period of transition from one class subject to another. And I think that being in this sense of being in between what the end of one time of class and a potentially new time of class is, I think, defines some of the difficulties that we have in conceptualizing a left-wing project. I'd like to look, though, at these kinds of ideas of autonomy, of anti-political ideas, because these are probably the most dominant ideas within the anti-capitalist movement, and certainly represent an important trend in the anti-globalization or ultra-globalization movement. And so the idea of autonomy, which were also the ideas of the beginnings of the labor movement in the 19th century, do these ideas herald the birth of a new subject? Can they be the basis for a new political subject? This is obviously the claim of Toni Negri, who sees in the rise of immaterial or cognitive labor the development of a networked cooperative form of labor. His key claim is that this new network form has broken free of capitalist control. In other words, the network now directly produces social life. And as such, this kind of spontaneous coordination, which is based in a new form of labor, gives birth to a new subject, which he calls the multitude. And he claims that its imminent, its internal self-organization is so powerful that capital can only survive as a parasitic system of command. So in other words, capital no longer controls the worker through the market, through the labor process, it can only control it externally. And it can only do so by mimicking, by adopting the same forms of organization as the network. So we now have a decentered, networked, and non-territorial form of power, which he calls empire. And I think what's interesting is that this thesis, or at least if we use another of the names that have kind of cropped up, the cognitariat, the cognitive worker, that this idea was greeted with acclaim, was extremely popular with researchers, artists, designers, and media workers in the ultra-globalization movement in the 2000s. And I think it was popular because it told them that capital was parasitically appropriating their unlimited creativity. And therefore, it actually played an important role in politicizing their emerging class consciousness. And so in a way, you could say that Empire is their communist manifesto, because it tells them that despite the misery and exploitation that they're experiencing, that they are nevertheless moving towards a higher form of society, and that they are themselves the bearers of this new society. So it provides a kind of narrative in which people can recognize themselves as a subject of change. And similarly, this concept plays an important role in the movement itself. Now, you know, we can debate how important it was, but I certainly think that the multitude within this idea, it allowed really rather different groups, movements and classes to actually unite, but as a single but diverse subject. At a time when the labour movement couldn't provide the basis for such a rallying, and it could unite them in the belief that together, but separately, they were building the future. So in other words, this is the idea of autonomy. In other words, we each separately, we are coming together to change the world. And so I think it provides a common language in which different kinds of opposition, often quite contradictory to the effects of neoliberalism, could find a kind of temporary reconciliation, could overcome some of their potential disagreements. And I think that this is why the idea of the commons was quite important. But obviously then we saw things like the war on terror, the universal state of emergency proclaimed by the US Empire. And that was immediately divisive, because, for example, the attack wing of the movement, the attack movement, considered this as not the key issue. The key issue was still the struggle against neoliberalism. So that wing divided itself immediately. So the question of politics was immediately divisive. So Negri's intervention enables a coming together, a subjectivization, but then is not able in and of itself to deal with concrete political problems. So in a way, I think that what we have to say is that despite the brilliance, I think, of Negri's intervention as a political intervention, it had limitations, and these limitations lay in the concept itself. I mean, I'm realizing that my time, this talk is probably 10 times too long, so I'll probably start to summarize a little bit from here. But essentially, Negri's talking about this kind of spontaneous unity. He's saying work unites us, but actually work also divides us, you know? And we can see this in precarity. The concept of the precarious labor is also a kind of involves the intensification of work. New technologies are being used to manage people at a distance, to increase the rate of exploitation. This is extremely divisive, because you have we have this discourse today of the privileged. Privileged worker with a wage in the public sector against those really hard-working people who can't get a job. Even Slavoj Žižek writes idiotic articles to this effect in The Guardian, for example. So it's the process of capitalist development is divisive. It doesn't merely create a collective labour process, it also creates antagonism through competition in the labour market. And I think that precisely because of this kind of destruction of the old working class, I think if we look at that, we can maybe explain the form of political organization of the movements. Because if you are dominated by the flexibility of time, in other words, if the 9-to-5 is a kind of prison, you know, and everyone feels this, but it's also oppressive to be constantly available, to be constantly disposable for capital. So if you live under this regime and you no longer inhabit a space like the factory or the office where you can create a form of collective life, of collective opposition, then there is an immediate problem in organizing. And therefore, the time of class, which I talked about before, the organizations over time within some kind of framework of progress and of political change, become actually quite difficult, and you move towards a concept of space. Hence, the Social Forum Summit, the occupation of a square, Occupy, the indignados, are all forms whereby the crisis of time, the problem of time, is resolved through space. Now, for Negri, his theory has the illusion that the movement simply extends itself over space. In other words, there's no political moment here. But it's clear that there is a problem of space, that there's a problem of the state, there's a problem with the generalization of the movement from particular groups of workers to workers as a whole, so to include trade unions, for example. And so therefore, and we see this as well, because sections of the indignados have split in Spain. Some people have gone for a hard autonomous position, some people want coalitions with the trade unions. So once again, the question of the politics of time rears its ugly head, as it were. So in a way, we can say that when talking about a political subject, we should reject the idea that class is some kind of simply some kind of essence that is expressed in that simply unfolds itself in space. I think that the problems of the movements demonstrate the problem of strategy and therefore the problem of politics. And that without some kind of hegemonic strategy, all that you can have is a movement of movements, as the name goes, and you know, the other name for the anti-globalization movement. In other words, all that you can have is a mobile ensemble, a mobile grouping of organization united for a given purpose, but whose survival, whose reproduction in time, is always under under the sign of under some sort of question. So I think Negri is evades the problem of politics. Now, I think that it's important, though, it's important to step back a moment and remember that, or rather to compare to see what Marx, what the position of Marx is here, because this is obviously the main reference point here in posing the question of a new politics. Marx doesn't start from an identity. In other words, he doesn't start from the idea that the collective character of work is, there is an identity between this collective character of work and a new collective society. He says that actually there's a contradiction between what he calls the forces and relations of production. So the contradiction between an increasingly socialized process of production and a privatized appropriation of a social product. So in other words, between the social character of work and the private character profit, of accumulation. And so, from Marx's point of view, capitalist society does generate the preconditions for socialism. So in other words, it socializes the productive forces, it concentrates production, and it creates a collective producer. So in other words, it provides some kind of material platform for a different logic. It also, and this is Marx's key claim, it also produces the gravedigger, in other words, the antagonist, the proletariat, the bearer of the new society. But, however, it does not allow this new potential to develop and conquer positions within the framework of capitalist society. And this is really the problem. And we can pose this, one way of looking at this is is provided by Lukács in his polemic with Rosa Luxemburg on the Russian Revolution. And you can call this the asymmetry, the lack of symmetry of the bourgeois and proletarian revolutions. So capitalism develops through commercial exchange in the in the womb, if you like, of feudal society. And the fact that it develops within feudalism enables the new ruling class to create powerful economic, political, and cultural positions within the old society, within the ancien regime. And therefore, the conquest of power, the creation of an actually bourgeois society, is merely the final act. It's kind of the icing on the cake, which crowns an already decisive change in the balance of forces. And that in itself means that revolution is not strictly speaking, political revolution is not strictly speaking necessary. And this was true historically. After the French Revolution, precisely because there is a general fear of further revolutionary change, you then have revolutions from above. And the German bourgeoisie is quite content to let German aristocrats and officers run German society in its interests. So revolution is not in itself necessary because capitalism developed as a system, as a dominant economic form within the old order. Now, the situation of the working class is the opposite, because it's completely dominated. It's separated from the means of production, it does not control the state apparatus, and it's also culturally dispossessed. So for Lukács, the revolution is the first revolution in history that requires a conscious collective effort. A certain level of organization and a consciousness of the goal. And all of this prior to the change that we to the transformation. So there has to be some kind of collective effort, some kind of a level of organization, and a consciousness of what we are trying to achieve. And therefore, a strategic perspective is required. And therefore, Marx is the first socialist to conceive of socialism as a mass political practice. And it's a practice that generalizes the struggles of the labor movement against exploitation of work, for civil rights, for social reform, and it turns this into one political class movement. And this movement, as it were, brings into the open the aim implied in the existence of the labor movement. In other words, it clarifies what it means to have an organized collective body within capitalism that only has its labor that is completely dispossessed of all other means. And so therefore, socialism is a political, specifically political act. And therefore, for Marxism, or for Marx, the organization of a political party is the first step in proclaiming the political independence of the working class from the bourgeoisie. It's the first step in linking the working class consciousness, which we can sort of crudely define as an awareness of the separate identity of the working class, a class with its own interests, and it's fusing this idea with some kind of hegemonic vision, a will to create a new social order, which we could call socialist consciousness. So our second conclusion is that in order to create a new political subject, in order to link personal and collective history, personal collective destiny in a movement for social change, we need to once again begin and take upon ourselves a strategic effort to unite the socialist idea with the working classes in a political party. So in other words, if we talk about a left alternative, we have to talk about a left party that can unite the existing forms of labor and their self-organization with socialist ideas. And that this is part and parcel of creating the basis of a political and social movement. However, I also think that we, in doing this, we have something to learn from autonomism. I think that I would argue that, well, we know that autonomism stresses the role of direct democracy. against bureaucracy. So direct democracy from below against bureaucratic structures. And for example, if we look at the uprising in Argentina in 2001 in response to its own debt crisis and financial crash, we see various forms of popular self-organization. The piqueteros, organizations of the unemployed, often under the influence of autonomism, organized assemblies which took on some of the day-to-day functions necessary to help people to survive the crisis. They grew food on waste land, they baked bread communally, they bartered jobs and services without relying on cash. They also occupied factories and restarted production under worker self-management. Now, what might Marx have said about this? I'd like to read a quote which is from the inaugural address of the First International, so from 1864. And this is, he's talking about the history of cooperatives, the movement established by Robert Owen. And he says, the value of these great social experiments cannot be overrated. By deed instead of by argument, so by action, they have shown that production on a large scale and in accord with the demands of modern science may be carried on without the existence of a class of masters employing a class of hands. That is, like slave labor, like serf labor, hired labor is but a transitory and inferior form destined to disappear before associated labor. To save the masses, cooperative labor ought to be developed to national dimensions and consequently to be fostered, meaning to be organized, by national means. Now, I think this is an interesting assessment, because Marx isn't saying, look, the piqueteros made a mistake, they didn't form workers' Soviets, they didn't take out Lenin's state and revolution. He actually takes this as an experience which is part of the construction of a socialist movement, because firstly, we need to show once more that socialism is possible. This is an idea that few people believe in any real sense. You can talk about socialism. One, nobody knows what you mean by it, but people are not really convinced. They want something different, but they don't know, they're not totally clear what that is. So experiences like this show that there is some alternative logic. Secondly, they show that that logic comes from the struggle of people themselves. It comes from below. The last point of Marx's quote is then the punchline. We need to extend these things to the national level. So in other words, the focus on the state becomes crucial. So we then can link talking about socialism again with struggles that are happening with a political movement against the state. And I think that in that sense, autonomism is interesting for us today, because we have collapsing economies across the Eurozone. Now, in Serbia and Croatia, employers don't pay wages for months. And this is a form of domination over the working class. This is now happening in Greece. So the question actually of taking overproduction and actually starting to control food and the distribution of services, water, and so on, is actually an actual question within the movement, and potentially is the basis for a challenge to the regime of hunger taking place. So in other words, we can actually learn from autonomism, and I'd like to even put this even more strongly. Now, some people laugh at Syriza's, the Greek left party. They laugh at the fact that Syriza organizes food kitchens, giving people soup, and kind of community aid centers. There are various Marxists going around saying, oh, this is charity work, you know, rubbish. Where's the revolution? But actually, I think that it's not just that these initiatives keep people from keep their chin up. They keep them from bowing their heads. They keep them from looking to fascism, to kind of a man on horseback. You know, it's not just that. I think that they recall a distant age when the labor movement controlled important economic, educational, welfare, and economic institutions. To take just one example, When they were founded at the end of the 19th century, the French Bourses du Travail were not just labor exchanges, but also centers for education and literacy. In other words, houses of the people. So in other words, for example, you know, in the ex-Yugoslavia, the left, you know, is obviously weaker, there is a kind of a battle within the NGO sector. What does the NGO sector mean? Who is it accountable to? European money, European liberalism, NATO imperialism, or could it become educational and cultural institutions of the workers' movement? You know, this is, so in other words, if we talk about the Bourses du Travail, we're actually talking about the NGO sector, for example, in ex-Yugoslavia and so on. So these were houses of the people. Now, I think one of the problems of the time of class, of the period after 1945, was a horrible statist culture developed on the part of socialists, even Marxists. And this is the kind of a reflex of delegating power to the state. So that today, when the state privatizes welfare, we simply say, stop the cuts. Let the state take over everything. In other words, we delegate all political initiative to the bureaucratic state. And I think that talking about the commons, the autonomous concept of the commons, unlike the kind of defense of the welfare state that we actually see in the movements, the protest movements in Europe, calls into question the market, and it calls into question bureaucratic control. So these kinds of initiatives and these kinds of demands, which are coming from autonomism, remind us that the crisis of the left is at least, to some extent, one of the loss of substance of labor organizations. In other words, the transfer of some of their key functions and therefore of their legitimacy to the state and to the market. So in other words, the problem is not I don't think the main problem is that, look, we can't reproduce the commons within capitalism. I think one of the problems is that for us to really have some kind of impact within the crisis, to turn it a crisis for them and not for us, we actually need to recover some kind of legitimacy to be able to actually present ourselves as speaking in the name of the popular interest. In other words, take charge of certain functions, to occupy certain sectors, to use that language, from which we can actually have some kind of claim to be a kind of for moral and political hegemony. I use kind of the Gramscian language. So we need actually some kind of moral authority. It's not simply saying who has the right demands. Oh, you haven't understood the function of debt. You're just talking about cuts. You know, it's not just it's not the list of demands that gets us there. We have to consider the fact that the lack of a political subject, the lack of a political party, but also how that party organizes itself. So in a way, I would say that we share a premise with autonomism, and that premise is autonomy. However, the movement from the state. However, for the Marxist tradition, this word autonomy has an opposite signification. So, if we remember if we return to Negri again, the realization of a new social logic is not the same. I don't agree with Negri that the new logic is not the same as the imminent extension of a social movement in space. But it depends on a political movement that replaces the state with a genuinely popular power. So autonomy comes through the transformation through political transformation, which opens up the possibility of a deeper social transformation. And I think this is why we have to reject the autonomous dogma that politics of all sorts, whether directed to reforming the system or to revolutionizing it, must be kept separate from the movement. The opposition between the movement and political parties is actually oddly similar to the traditional divisions within the labor movement between its economic and political wings. And this is the dominant form of labor movement, of the reformist labor movements in the West. So you have the trade unions with their economic demands, and you have the social democratic parties with their political demands. So you have the opposition and separation between economics and politics. But I would argue that such a division merely adapts to the formal separation of economics and politics under capitalism. And here I think we should return to Marx's On the Jewish Question, which identifies the central problem of modern democracy as the separation of bourgeois and citoyen. So the private egotistical individual of civil society on the one hand, and the citizen, the participant in the abstract political community of the state. So with the development of a separate realm of legal rights and political liberties, this new political realm is based on the structural separation of political life from economic and social life in general. However, as Marx famously argues, the formal equality of the citizen masks the domination of the bourgeois. So, in a way, we could say that the reformist, in other words, the division between economic and political wings of the movement, this division shares what the young Marx called Hegel's political illusion. In other words, the worship of the bureaucratic state as some kind of representative of the universal interest. Marx argues that with the separation of the economic and the political, the real divisions in society are displaced, are pushed away into the imaginary and abstract unity of the state. But his point is that the state that presents itself as reconciling opposing interests in a separate and autonomous and equal sphere of politics is the same that is dominated by the economic power of capital. So, in other words, what's happening is that there is a kind of a political illusion which is the same, which in turn creates a social illusion. In other words, I think that the autonomist position, which basically believes in the self-sufficiency of the social movement, which we can see also in Indignados and Occupy, is a form of this separation of economics and politics. So just as Hegel believes that the state can reconcile competing interests in society, so the opposite illusion is to believe that you can reconcile interests, the conflicts within society without transforming the state. So, in other words, you have the same separation, but the other way around. So, you have a political illusion which breeds a social illusion. And I think this is a real problem because this kind of separation reinforces the idea that conflicts within society can be reconciled by the state. It depoliticizes them. It contains these conflicts because it reduces them to conflicts between private interest groups. The labor movement today is seen as a kind of a private interest, a corporate interest, a selfish interest, and no longer as a class interest. So in other words, this kind of separation between economics and politics subjects the movement as a whole, and I don't just mean the autonomists, I mean the labor movement as it exists today, to the political domination of capitalism. We accept the form of its domination. And so in a way, what we're doing, what autonomism does, is it abandons political politics to basically the neoliberal parties, in other words, the parties of order. It's very hard to fight a battle if you don't contest it, you know. I think that would be that would be my point. But however, by contrast, the political party, a socialist party, is a kind of a break with the natural environment of civil society, precisely because it's a conscious collectivity which seeks to transform social relationships. So, in other words, instead of it's not a direct translation of economic class interests. It's not even a passive reflection of the way in which work is structured. a socialist party unites not only workers but intellectuals, elements of the middle classes, oppressed minorities, and so on. Its form of unity is political and transformative. It's united by its final goal, not its immediate interest. And therefore, I think this is the strength of actually a political movement, because it's a negation of society as it exists now. And if the kind of party we have is one that's integrated with by a political strategy, and it has a unified perspective, and it therefore intervenes in the movement, in the trade unions, and in Parliament in a coherent way. In other words, it doesn't intervene in the movement to win votes, simply win votes, but to organise the popular movement. And it uses Parliament to strengthen the movement outside the framework of the state, then we can say that it overcomes this division between economics and politics. It doesn't leave the political field to the parties of order, but nor does it accept the rules of the game. It doesn't accept the structural logic that now enforces political choices under capitalism. So, in a way, I think we should stop talking about resistance. Resistance is actually quite a new term, I think, in the historical lexicon. People used to talk about struggle, which is possibly somewhat old-fashioned, but I think is struggle suggests and something that we've organized rather than something that's forced upon us, something that we can't control. I don't think the word resistance even comes from the language of the movements of the Second World War, the anti-fascist movements. I think it probably comes from postmodernism. Because resistance is basically, with postmodernism, you have only kind of eternal resistance, a resistance that actually depends on the thing that it is resisting. So, power, Foucault's power and resistance. Concept of biopower. This kind of resistance, so it depends on something that has to be resisted, but it stops. Because basically there's something which it is forbidden to it, which it can't think about. It's a kind of a blind spot, and that blind spot is a new order. So in other words, we have eternal resistance. We don't have a perspective of where that resistance goes. We merely have endless resistance. Because if we try and go beyond the state order that exists today, we are told that something terrible will happen. The liberals call this totalitarianism. From the postmodernists, in a more philosophical language, say more or less the same thing. They talk about the will to power. The politics of resistance is a reflection of this social movement that lacks a politics. And therefore it can't open a horizon of emancipation that integrates the personal and the collective in a forward movement towards some kind of final socialist goal. And therefore, returning to our discussion of Negri and multitude, it cannot provide the basis of a political subject that can survive in time. Because otherwise, look, without some kind of strategy, political strategy, resistance becomes episodic. It uses itself up. We become tired. We abandon the battlefield. And we've seen this before in the anti-capitalist movements, that out of desperation, people fall into the arms of the social liberal parties. This has happened in France on a number of occasions. And France, after Greece, is the country where we've seen the most powerful movements of the last 20 years. It happened in the American anti-war movement, where they couldn't stop the war, so what did they do? They supported John Kerry's presidency, a man who had supported the Iraq war from the very beginning. So in other words, as Marx also says in the same inaugural address, if a political abstention in effect pushes workers into the arms of the parties of order. So I think we have a historic responsibility there. So in a way, my conclusion, I think, in a way, my argument is that in reply to Fukuyama today, his provocative statement that the problem is not the end of history, but that history won't end, that we can't have a left, that this problem is linked to anti-politics and the lack of political strategy. And here, I think, I'd like to, though, I'd like to sort of suggest, give at least one reason, one further reason why a left party can take us forward, to use the language of progress. If you think about it, apart from its domination of the state, capital as money, is a medium of power that's actually almost universally transformable. Capital can be transformed into control of information media. It can turn itself into resources for a lockout of workers. It can support a propaganda campaign. It can provide funds for a political party. It can buy money for weapons in a social crisis. In other words, capital has a number of forms in which it can dominate society, more than simply economic power or control of the state. And therefore, we require a symmetrical form that can also rapidly transform itself in order to counter the kind of the clashes, the to and fro, the contingency, the sudden changes that are the stuff of politics. And I would suggest that a left party, a radical left party, can be seen exactly as an attempt to create this kind of what I would call a polyvalent potential of political action. A potential that can be crystallized swiftly in a number of different fields, fields that are interchangeable. Elections, demonstrations, boycotts, agitation, political education, strikes. In Latin America, we've even seen insurrections in Bolivia. And the reason why it can it's a form that it's interchangeable and has great flexibility is precisely because it has a constant and single-minded aim, and that aim is the conquest of power. So it's precisely the single-mindedness of a political project that enables great tactical flexibility and audacity to seize the time. This is the time of crisis of capital. It may not be in 10 years' time. You know, the aperture, the horizon has now opened, but there is no guarantee that it will resolve itself. So in other words, history, you know, against Negri, politics is when you say that history is not inevitable. I think that this is part of the strength of a political approach, because it encourages us to think of politics neither as eternal resistance, nor as merely spontaneous explosions, nor even gradual evolution. It challenges us to think of politics as a kind of practice that tries to transform the conditions under which it acts. So in other words, it's transformative. In other words, it's not reactive, it's transformative. And part of this is to take advantage of the kind of fractures, the kind of conflicts, the lines of division, what Lenin calls the weak link at a given moment. And I think that today in Europe, those kinds of points of pressure that we can apply relate to the fusion of economic and political crisis. The bailouts, the fiscal stimulus of 2008, didn't resolve the debt crisis. What it in fact did was it brought together private and public debt crises. So it interlocked them. And you can see this in Cyprus today, because the Cypriot debt crisis is the result of the fact that they cashed in big time into the Greek debt after 2008, believe it or not. So as Greece was collapsing, the Cypriot banks bought up Greek debt because they thought that being a member of the Eurozone would guarantee that debt, and that this would be a nice profitable transaction. And what it did was it blew a hole into them. So you have an interlocking of private and public debt crises. Now, the response of the European elites is to launch what are, in effect, coup d'etat, but of a kind of a soft kind, legislative coup d'etat against representative democracy, in order to basically push through austerity and neoliberalism. And I'm talking about the fiscal pact, for example, but also preemptively, I think it's interesting that in Eastern Europe, governments have been passing these laws anyway. So I think Romania and Croatia passed a fiscal responsibility laws, which is a laughable concept. And I think that I read an IMF report which says that there was an agreement with the previous Slovenian government to establish such a law, but I don't know whether it's gone through. But at any rate, the fiscal pact. Well, what does that mean? It means that there will be severe fines on member states whose budget deficit climbs above 0.5% of GDP. So this is a permanent mechanism of neoliberal pressure on wages and social spending. In other words, you have to balance the budget, and therefore budgets are balanced by cutting social spending. And this mechanism is now hardwired into national politics. And I think that this is a historical regression to a period before the rise of modern representative democracy. In other words, the people's representatives will govern, but it will be the banks that will rule. We will be taxed, but not represented, to invert, to use the formula of the American War of Independence. So, and we can say that the entire evolution of the institutions of the EU is exactly this kind of coup d'etat. Because what's been happening is that the accountability of national parliaments in the areas of monetary and interest rate policy, and now in taxation and spending, has been replaced with an unelected bureaucracy of national and EU officials. And I think it's important to recognize that this is not a problem of Brussels. This is a problem of the internal mechanisms of executive privilege in liberal democracies that enable state administrations to actually dominate parliaments. So it arises from an internal tendency of liberal democracy. The young Marx would have seen this as an attempt to displace class contradictions to a level at which they cannot be opposed by the oppressed. So in other words, if you take away these things from any kind of democratic accountability, you in effect depoliticize them. They're no longer part of political discussion. They are simply part of a framework, and they're not even here, they're in Brussels. So we can play the game of we're not responsible, they are, they're not, who is, we don't know. So it's fate. So this kind of usurpation of democracy, I think, is a key issue for us. So in other words, I would argue that the present phase of the crisis, seen most clearly in Greece, but also in the technical government in Italy, that it takes the form of a crisis of democracy. So we have to link the struggle against neoliberalism with the struggle for democracy. So I would argue that this involves a struggle for a people's default on the debt, the nationalization of the banks and industry under popular supervision. But also I think that in various parts of Europe we see an issue of a struggle against neocolonialism, of neocolonial domination by the Troika. And I think that the way in which we could begin to talk about this possibly is of a struggle for a real people's democracy. in other words, a genuine social democracy. And I think that putting these demands, these kind of demands into practice, requires a conscious struggle against the economic and political structures of the EU and the Eurozone. So the struggle for democracy is linked to the struggle against neoliberalism, but I think that this has to be integrated into a political struggle against the European Union as it stands now. And I think that this kind of struggle, the significance of this is that we reject the kind of trend that where we simply say, look, we have the real democracy of the movements, you know, the movements of the squares, of Occupy and so on, to merely fake democracy. So we have fake capitalist democracy, but we have real democracy here in this square. I think that we let them, we once again abandon the political field if we don't take this issue of the crisis of democracy seriously. Because in a way, if we don't struggle for freedom within political institutions, which means forming political parties that fight for representation in national parliaments, we fail to expose the limits placed on democracy by the state, and not just by capital. So in other words, I was talking to Primoz today and just remarked about how interesting it was that you have a new government in Slovenia, but you haven't had elections. And the mechanisms of state privilege ensure that order is always maintained in moments of crisis. So one government is broken by popular protest. Well, we can't have a period of political uncertainty. The state creates a new government. So in a way, if we don't expose these kinds of mechanism, we actually don't develop the sense of freedom, an expansive political consciousness of freedom, which I would again argue was part of the historical legacy of the left in the 19th century and in the first part of the 20th century. We have a very, very limited sense of what we want, a very narrow, almost economistic sense. Our concept of freedom is narrow, it's abstract, it's one-sided. And political freedom provide one of Marx's most important arguments, and it was contested at the time by the anti-political trend, is that political freedoms provide the necessary medium for free political action on the part of the working class. Political freedoms, the right to free association, for example, the right to press freedom, and so on, are the necessary means by which the working class pursues its strategic goal. So through all-round political action, the working class educates itself in its historic interests and organizes itself to struggle for a new social order. So it's through the experience of the social divisions at the level of society as a whole that the class is established. Class is not the narrow expression of the struggle of within work. It's actually the understanding of the way in which this struggle is structured and articulated at the level of society as a whole. To understand that the working class has allies, that it has urgent and important democratic interests that it has to defend, that it has to defend minorities who are under attack, because its project is universal, it's not corporate. It's not that of a corporate body. So I would connect the interest of the struggle for democracy is that it can begin to pose the crisis of democracy can provide the space for a new party of the left, and through political action we can begin to overcome some of the weaknesses of the social movements that we've seen and to begin to open a space for concrete alternatives. I'd end that. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Andrea, for the lecture. We have half an hour left for discussion, so if you have any questions or comments. You can also post questions in Serbo-Croatian if it's more comfortable.
Ja sam Marko, srpski pričati. Zanima me tvoj, vaš pogled na državu, kako razumete državu. Kakva je njena uloga, dakle, da li je u leninističnom smislu razumete kao levičar, da kažem tako, ili u kom smislu i onda postavit će uvjeti, pošto onda od toga zavisi da li će imati još potpitanje.
Da li ga razumem na leninistički način? Aha. Pa dobro, jeste u principu, zato što ja mislim da je to marksistički, to je Marksova teorija. I spoke a little bit about the separation between economics and politics. Now, Marx argues that with capitalism differs from other forms of class society in that exploitation is no longer extra economic. In other words, it doesn't involve the fusion of economic and political power. So, in other words, the aristocracy, through its control of political power, is able to exploit the peasantry. So you have a fusion there of economic and political power. For Marx, the exploitation of labor takes place within the framework of competitive capital accumulation and the labor process. So you have the separation of the economic from the political sphere. You also have the separation of the worker from the means of production, and so therefore you have the presuppositions for a sphere that is formally independent of the capital relation. So in other words, a sphere of formal equality. However, I would reject, for example, it then depends. I mean, I would reject the formulation of the relative autonomy of the state. I would prefer to talk about the structural interrelationship, the structural interdependence of the market and the state. But I would say that the state is a capitalist state, if that was your question.
Do you think maybe that the re-establishment of socialism is easier established in a country that was before in a real socialism than in some Western countries?
that's a good question. I don't know, what do you think? No, go on, don't just ask me. This is not an academic seminar, you know. Or what do you think?
I think it is easier.
Go on.
Because people are stronger. If we had socialism, good body education.
I don't know, I just analyzed, I don't know, the reactions of when the guys from the Workers' Funds University started to talk about democratic socialism, and I didn't find really hard negative responses to the re-establishment of socialism. I thought that it would be a lot harder to re-establish socialism, where the response of the right wing and also others would be a lot worse than it was.
But the left is extremely weak, though, in the ex-Yugoslavia. I mean, I'm not really sure. I'd be interested in what people think. I mean, I sometimes wonder whether it's what you have rather than some kind of continuity is essentially a contrast, which maybe we can relate to today. And that contrast is the very familiar idea, which even philosophers, I mean, Raskolnikov once came down. You know, his punchline was, "Well, we used to live better," you know, And I almost fell over laughing, because I thought, well, yeah, okay, but what is the implication of the fact that we used to live better? Why then did we live worse, and then why did we all start, you know, why then was there a set of civil wars which opened up the region to...
Zato što su ljudi spoštovali jednu drugu, da sad niko ne gleda nekog I priča nešto tako bez veze. E pa zato.
I don't know, I was speaking English, so I really understand. I also come from Serbia, but it is really crucial to understand that in, okay, maybe in Slovenia not, but in the rest of the Western Balkans, so to say, the leftist ideas are not relevant. Nationalistic questions and things are posed above them just to so that people would forget how they really live, so to say. So they mask the real questions with nationalistic themes, and so people do not even think about that it is possible to live again in some socialistic society or state or whatever. So I really think that in the ex-Yugoslavia, I wouldn't agree with you that it would be easier to re-establish, because we, first of all, don't have a real left party, although no, even in Slovenia, that is not the leftist party. I mean, just so it's really hard. So we should start with strategic, I don't know, project.
Yeah, but maybe Serbia and Croatia are more specific than Slovenia, because nationalism is a lot stronger in Serbia and in Croatia, also because of the war, because it was a lot worse than the 10-day war in Slovenia. So I think that the nationalism is a lot worse in Serbia and Croatia than in Slovenia.
I'm not sure.
I don't know. I think that actually it's a lot weaker than it was. I mean, for example, when Karadzic and Mladic were arrested, I actually happened to be in Belgrade both times, and the demonstrations were pathetic, you know?
Yeah.
It was like, they looked like losers.
Yeah.
I mean, I think what happened in the recent EU judge, the Hague judgments in favor of ethnic cleansing, for example, with Gotovina, was a kind of a hegemonic intervention in basically to do with EU-Russian competition and to do with the Kosovo question. So there was another round of divide and rule. But I thought that the reaction in Croatia was interesting in that it was a kind of a collective sigh of relief, a sort of a sense of guilt towards the big other. In other words, the Europeans think that we're all divljaci, basically. And now we can all agree to forget. So, you know, there is this, you know, the national question continues to exist. But I don't necessarily think that that's the reason. But that's what I'm trying to say. That's the main problem. I mean, for example, the Narodnjaci in Serbia. They are nationalists, but they are pro-EU now, and it's through them that social opposition to the market is expressed. That's what social democracy is in Serbia. I mean, it's not very good, but that's workers identify with them because they perceive them as a social option. So at the moment, I think that you can say that there is class, I think there is class consciousness, but the way it's being expressed, it doesn't have a clear political crystallization. I mean, to use the example in my talk earlier, the anti-fascist activist that I was talking about from the 40s, Ida Szabo, she was actually she became very much pro Milosevic, and then the interview that I did was very difficult to publish because it became a great Serbian rant, but from a socialist position. Now, you know, the language of the 1930s was dead, but she could recall it, and frankly, it sounded better to me than some of the Western kinds of radical leftism, the way she formulated what they did in the 30s. However, that was a tradition that had died. And the way in which she identified the left project was the defense of the nation state against mondializacija, you know, which is the Mihailo Marković position. So once again, that there are kind of political questions that have to be resolved if we take things forward. Now, you know, it's interesting that, you know, that in Slovenia you have actually quite a powerful workers' movement. And I think that this is, this is something different, and that this is, this provides a kind of cohesion for some kind of left project. I mean, it's you know, I was talking to Primož, and he was telling me about the various difficulties and so on. But I think that that is something that that eventually will create political options, because if the state is constantly being used to enforce neoliberal laws, then eventually there will be splits within the unions on political questions. They may not happen immediately, but there's always the potential. And especially well-organized trade unions that mobilize people. I mean, I'm very impressed by what the unions have done in Slovenia. I mean, I live in the UK, for Christ's sake, you know? We had a few big one-day strikes 1 year ago. And this is in the fourth year of wage freezes in the public sector. And then years of basically nothing being done by the trade unions. What was achieved in Slovenia is much more impressive than even in certain Western countries. And I think that that actually is the basis for trying to unify elements that have come out of the social movement with the trade union movement. But that is part of some kind of longer term process where I guess ways have to be found to organize joint activities, you know, yeah.
If I may just remark that, I think that the huge problem of the trade unions is that they're only focused on the wages. Not about how many people do work, can work, will work, but only on the wages. Not about, at least I get that impression here in Slovenia, where I now study, that the main question is the wages and how many money will be assured for the wages in the public sector. And they actually only focus on one thing. It is important, but I think there are also other questions that should be addressed from the trade unions in order to start some, forming a hegemonic block in Gramscian sense, I don't know how to say.
But is that true?
Do
people want to intervene? Do people think that the unions just focus on wage demands?
Well, more or less, but yeah. Trade unions are trade unions. They are not a political party.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course, it is their business, and of course they...
Yeah, there are limitations.
Doing what they're doing.
But they led the campaign, for example, against the referendum on the toxic bank. That's a political intervention. Even in Serbia, you have a very, very small trade union called Sloga, which was a pro-Milosevic union, and its politics is still problematic, which organized solidarity demonstrations with Greece. Now, that's a form of internationalism. Okay, they can have the, you know, orthodox symbols sorted in the background, you know, and that makes it okay. We're going to do internationalism, but it's not real internationalism, so you don't need to arrest us. Yeah, you don't need to arrest us all. But still, that's a kind of a step forward for a trade union. So, you're right, as you said, you know, the trade unions have a particular function, but they're also pushed as well to establish to intervene politically. You know, the trade unions established the Labour Party in the UK, and it took the best part of half a century of capitulating to liberalism. And even then, the only reason why they went for it in the end was that the liberal government was complicit in legislation that would have limited their ability to bargain industrially. And then they said, we've had it, we're going to go for the Labour Party. Otherwise, even then, they wouldn't. You know, we still wouldn't have had a Labour Party in Britain. So, you know, they're not a political party. They both express the fact of exploitation and also challenge it. But in so doing, they organize the kind of exploitation of labor within the workplace. And that's the kind of, you know, paradox of a trade union.
One should be very careful when evaluating the social and political role of the trade unions, because it's very easy to fall into this trap, which is precisely the liberal discourse. Look at these trade union leaders, they drive Mercedes and say they want even higher wages while people are out of work. So this is one of the creations of antagonisms you were talking about. And but they still deserve criticism, and criticism is due. So it's very slippery ground. But you mentioned the example of the taxi bank. Also, the trade unions resisted the flat tax rate, and they also resisted very strongly the new social legislative. And as far as I know, there were only two groups. There were social workers or professors of social works and trade unions that actually said anything in public about the new social legislation, which is really extremely brutally neoliberal. Mm-hmm. So this was quite a positive gesture, and it had nothing to do with trade unions as such. They didn't have to intervene, but they did. Okay. So this is perhaps another example. Sorry.
Like to make a very small remark, because you mentioned a few examples of Latin America, and it's really interesting to compare these two different geographical zones, because we had very similar austerity measures that's taking place now under the Washington Consensus, and right after the Washington Consensus, we had this turn to the left in the continent, which before that the left was really weak, and there was different experience taking place all over the region, especially Evo Morales and Hugo Chavez. And it's interesting how they managed to change the discourse within party politics at the same time, but they left some space open for social movements, especially Hugo Chavez. He always incentivated these cooperatives, and it's really I think an example that you can think of how to create a counter-hegemonic discourse in the regional level. Because what's taking place now in Europe, especially this in Greece, the relation, like you mentioned, is neo-colonial completely. Even the last book of Ulrich Beck is the German Europe. You know, so it's a tendency to more or less do the same thing that happened with us, but when you have these really terrible conditions, it seems like some spontaneous solidarity takes part, so perhaps you can establish a new discourse and move towards this direction.
I mean, when I sort of wrote out this talk, in my mind I had a slight, there was a slight ambiguity, because I wondered, is Latin America an exception? Or is it an exception that proves the rule? I mean, I'm talking about the language of socialism, the language of revolution. I've read a couple of books, but I wouldn't pretend to be an expert on how a Bolivian cocoa grower perceives themselves. I mean, you know, there's a very interesting book I read by Garcia Linera, the vice president of Bolivia. And, you know, he follows the concept of the multitude, but in a much more realistic sense, not in Negri's kind of high philosophy or high political economy. He says, look, essentially, the multitude is what happens when a particular time of class, a particular working class is fragmented, and it finds that it can't organize it, it can only organize itself through space within community networks, but it uses some of the old techniques. It no longer has a coherent kind of. He argues that there's no longer a hegemonic class subject. But I don't know whether he meant that philosophically or whether he meant that in Bolivia. But he also says that with the kind of neoliberal collapse, people also there's a kind of community form of organization. So Bolivia had revolutions based on the trade union form. You know, the trade union was the framework of life, and the revolution in 52 happened through the trade union. So again, a counterfactual to a simple critique of trade unions. Trade unions can also be revolutionary under certain. So the trade union form became the multitude form, which because you've kind of got a community form that's emerging. And so you can have a half peasant, half sort of half worker combination. But that could be the basis of a new political subject. The problem is that Linera in power is not a politician of the multitude. He says, well, we can't reform, we can't challenge capitalism maybe in 50 years, which is a kind of a classic social democratic. Yeah, we have to calm down, comrades. You know,
the nice thing that he did is that he didn't just use the traditional rhetoric towards the working class, but he allowed some space for this indigenous subjectivity emerge. Mm. And that was the secret. But I also agree that the concept of the multitude, perhaps it can well illustrate these initial gatherings and so on, but it doesn't bring a project. But I think Ernesto Laclau, the way he develops populism and the idea of hegemony, brings this, how can you articulate different demands in society in a coherent way, in perhaps channelize this to a party structure. That could be a little bit more helpful.
But what is the actual political position of Laclau? I mean, he talks about radical democracy, but I mean, you can say that you can be a right winger in Eastern Europe and have the same position. A NATO supporter, and you know, we want radical civil society and all that bullshit. It doesn't mean anything.
Yeah, that's the problem if you steer, I think, because it brings this idea of the empty signifier that you can address different demands of society, but you can take this to a totally different way.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think, look, I think that the Latin American example is very, very interesting. It's just that it doesn't convince people in Europe, which is why one has to make the argument for the left. You know, you have to try and show how we could do it, because people just don't find that convincing. There's a layer of people that go, yeah, Morales is fantastic, Chavez is fantastic, but unfortunately we can't build a movement that way, you know. But yes, you're right. Chavez and Morales have been part of a process where there is now a new left, a genuine left. Well, there is the Labour Party, which still has is based on the trade unions, although some trade unions have disaffiliated. The current leader, dealing with the kind of catastrophe of the last years of Tony Blair, differentiated himself just a little bit. In other words, he's not openly Blairite, but he doesn't reject the essential legacy of that project. He now uses the language of 19th century liberalism. He talks about one nation politics, which is what the conservatives in the 1950s and 1960s in Britain talk, their way of controlling kind of class contradictions. So he's widely perceived as useless. But there is, within the Labour Party, there's still a very, very organised network of Blairites who are trying to undermine him. So the Labour Party kind of remains embarrassed about its entire history and ineffective for that reason. To the left of the Labour Party, there was a project that emerged from the movements around Seattle, the anti-war movement, which was essentially based on the anti-war movement, which united people from the Labour left, the far left, and radicalized members of the Muslim community. It was called Respect. But that fragmented a few years ago. And since then, there have been a number of conflicting campaigns. I think sectarianism and the lack of politics is one of the main problems at the moment, because we've had a kind of a delegitimation of parliament just before the last elections, where there was a scandal for expenses, and it was kind of so hilariously petit bourgeois, you know, sort of people using expenses to redo their kitchens, you know, and to have second mortgages, because they politics is now business, you know. And if we talk about the heroic entrepreneur, well, why can't we live like capitalist kings, you know? And when people found out about that, they were very angry. But the left wasn't able to capitalize on that, because there wasn't any left of the left party. Now we have scandals in the BBC, which, you know, which involved the relationship between the police and the media in terms of kind of intrusive journalism and so on. So you have a number of crises within British institutions, but we don't have any left party to articulate them politically. So you have a kind of mood against politics that's, I think, probably benefits the right, the nationalist right, in the longer term. And you have campaigns, you have anti-cuts movements, you have some trade union supporting candidates, you have some other left party supporting candidates, but you don't have a coherent movement united behind either a political project or an anti-cuts project. And I think that that's a kind of a big problem. Until that problem is solved, I think that whilst the Conservatives may lose the next election, the cuts will simply continue.
Okay,
sada
imamo još 5 minut, tako da še jedno vprašanje zadnje.
I'm interested in what do you think about the strange thing that happened in 2008 when bank went bankrupt and everything. The change of discourse that not the banks were guilty, but the public sector and the state are those that spend more than they can produce. It's like introducing microeconomy to macro level. You know what I mean? I'm really fascinating, and I am critical to the left or to the intellectual left that they, I know, or at least I do not perceive it like that. That they do not address that question enough, and that problem, that shift that happened, because that is a crucial thing. Why we have today these austerity measures, because they manage to change the discourse in the public sphere. How do you explain? I mean, they're capitalist, the Leninistic understanding of the state and everything, but still it is fabulous that they managed to do that, and there's not a single voice that is heard around the globe.
Well, okay, there are more criticisms than you're allowing for, but I guess it is an interesting kind of intellectually speaking, and politically it is interesting, and I think it's, in a way, the answer is actually quite simple, and it's the social power of the market. It's complete hegemony means that, you know, what did they do? They decided, unlike in the 1930s, to intervene to save the financial system. That meant that essentially they had mountains of debt then, and they then had to start to pay that debt back. And who was going to pay for that? Well, obviously not bankers. It was going to be the people. So immediately the IMF reports, instead of saying we had a profligate economic model, you know, we had a completely irrational, I mean, obviously within their terminology, not the one that I would share, but they would say we had a lack of regulation, which meant that there wasn't a legal framework that allowed for rational financial investment decisions, right? So, i.e. a typical capitalist boom, you know, speculative boom. The IMF reports changed overnight to saying the state, we've been spending too much, and therefore we need more neoliberal reform. So as soon as austerity was necessary, the line shifted. And the reason why it's it was accepted is that very few people really think that there's an alternative to the market. So if the market is in crisis, you have to save the market. So it's quite simple. And then you sell it as kind of, well, what do you want? Armageddon. Do you want the end
Why?
Of the world?
Why? Do you sell yourself for sale? Why do you sell these things?
Which things?
Which you talk about.
We have ran out of time. And the rational questions, apparently...
Those are all bullshit to say.
Okay. In the back odzadi lahko kupite majice z, mislim, če že ne prodajamo samo bullshit, ampak tudi materialne stvari, kot so recimo majice z Marksom, danes samo za 10 evrov različne knjige od Sofije, pa vabili tudi naslednjič Barbara Kresal predava o evropski delovni zakonodaji, o evropskem prilagajanju na njo, tako da naslednjič četrtek ob 6. Hvala.